To the Floating Truffaut podcast. I am your host, Luke, and today we will be continuing our installment on the French New Wave series we're going with. It's our fourth installment, I believe, and we are going to be focusing more on the Left Bank group of the French New Wave. And if you don't know what the Left Bank group of the French New Wave is essentially it is a way of people kind of grouped a lot of the French New Wave directors that like weren't a part of the Cahier Du Cinema group, which we talked about last episode. And the four most prominent directors in that group are Agnès Varda, Jacques Demy, Alain, Resnais, and Chris Marker. And to start off, I think we're going to basically compare them to each other and with the Cahier Du Cinema group. And so before we get on to that, here are my co-hosts, Danny.
Hello.
And Blake.
What's up?
And to start this off, I feel like the question we should really discuss is, what differences, like what separates Cahier Du Cinema from the Left Bank group in general, do you think?
I mean, I guess just to take it at a literal version, a literal way of answering that question is one of the groups, you know, wrote literally as critics about movies,
yeah.
You know, and the other really didn't. I mean, I guess a way to put this is a lot of the writing of the Left Bank group is just directly in their movies.
That's fair, yeah.
You know, a lot of them, yeah. Especially with Marker and Varda and kind of Rene too, they're all very essay movies, you know, the writing is in the movies.
Yeah.
But, you know, just to take out a little version, Godard, Truffaut, they were all writing literally in a magazine called Cahier Du Cinema, yeah. As critics, and you don't really get that with the other group, so I guess.
Okay.
At least that's what comes to my mind first, because just when I think about it, it's way easier for me to be like, it's way easier for me to know the influences of the Cahier Du Cinema group because of all their writing.
Yeah.
And it's a little hard. I mean, Marker literally made a movie about Kurosawa and Tarkovsky.
Yeah.
You know, so it's not that hard if you look, but
yeah.
It's a little different, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like, of course, Left Bank made a lot more. I feel like, when I think about Left Bank and, like, the differences between the two,
mm-hmm.
I generally think about, like, all the documentaries that the Left Bank are prominent for.
Mm-hmm.
And like when you think of Cahier Du Cinema, you don't really think of documentaries because I mean,
yeah.
I think they did.
Unless you like, especially if you take Godard out of it, because Godard is basically like everywhere, you know.
Yeah.
He made so many movies and all types of movies. You can, to me, he feels way more, like sometimes some of his movies feel way more like Left Bank movie, and then some of them feel more like you're saying,
Cahier
Du Cinema movie.
Godard's all over the place.
But definitely with the other directors, I feel like in the Cahier Du Cinema group, way less documentaries.
Yeah.
Like Romer. None that I can think of in his features.
No, I don't. I can't think of any from him.
I know he made some like documentaries for French TV before he started making movies, but
yeah. And although his movies do feel like documentaries, kind of.
But that's
like,
different. Yes.
Yeah.
That's actually a good way to tie in all of these directors. All of them have that documentary aspect.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. The boots on the ground. That's
boots
what they.
The
that's what this whole wave is known for, and they,
yes.
These ones are definitely
very,
known for.
You
it
notice
too.
That.
Yes. You do.
Especially if you.
Especially
you know,
Marker. And,
or if you're coming out of the 40s and 50s and you're only used to studio movies.
Yeah.
You can see why everyone would group these all together.
Yeah.
You know? And part of that's a lot of that has to do, and they would have admitted this, is a lot of this has to do with the technology at the time getting better to where they could actually go film on the
yeah.
street. You know.
Yeah.
You didn't need great lighting to still get a good image.
Yeah.
Or. They later on they started being able to carry boom mics around and just everything got easier to do with less people versus making a movie in the 40s where you had to have all this equipment and all these people working on them because the cameras weren't as good.
Yeah, and so just going off of that, one of the movies that we're going to be talking about later is Umbrellas of Cherbourg, and we all watched a documentary about that also called Once Upon a Time Umbrellas of Cherbourg, I think,
yeah.
Or an Umbrellas of Cherbourg.
It's just
and,
like Once Upon a Time Umbrella.
It was a French
Cherbourg.
TV
okay.
documentary about the movie.
Right? Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Yeah, and one of my favorite quotes in that movie was whenever they were actually talking, like the interviewer was talking to Demi about Umbrellas of Cherbourg, and they're talking about girls around the city wearing bows around their hair like she is in the movie, and he says, "It does strangely resemble Catherine's hairdo. It's nice to see film taking to the streets and the streets mimicking films. It's come full circle."
That's a great quote.
And it's like, it really does kind of just encapsulate just the French New Wave in general. Like, that is kind of just what happened.
Yeah.
They're trying to bridge the gap between what a character in a movie feels like versus a character in real life feels like, right?
Yeah.
It's trying to, you know, bring those two things closer together.
They didn't even only affect their own country. Like, the French people, they also infected the world, you know?
Yeah, they did.
In general.
Yes.
Which is interesting.
And I guess... That actually reminds me of another point in the differences between the Cahier Du Cinema Group and Left Bank, especially in terms of influence. Because of that Cahier Du Cinema label, just literally because of that to some degree, those directors became more influential a lot of the times.
Mm-hmm.
Versus
yeah.
Varda, especially now lately, I think she's becoming more popular.
Yes.
I hope so.
But and also Chris Mark. I mean, Chris
and
Mark.
And Demy's
like,
getting popular just with a certain group of people,
yes.
regardless, because
oh, yes.
he's got amazing movies for those
but,
group
like,
of people.
Yeah.
Just the fact that when you, for most of history after the French New Wave ended, most people would think of Truffaut, Godard, especially those two.
Yeah.
But you know, the Cahier Du Cinema Group, they would think
yes.
of the writings as well, right? And so that just by definition leaves out a lot of directors like Varda,
yeah.
or Marker. But
all right. Well, now I guess we should talk about the similarities between the Left Bank group in general. I mean, differences. I mean,
okay.
or
yes.
Which one were we talking about?
I
mean,
I think the way we could talk about this is, because the real similar, at least in my opinion, the real similarities are between Resnais, Varda, and Marker.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, they definitely have similarities.
And then
Demy's just trotting all along. You
know, hey. No, see, Demy is he fits into the French wave at least in terms of. He's his own person, you know, the whole auteurship
yeah.
aspect of his movies, right?
I mean, every French
director
movie.
Does,
though.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a huge part of it, right?
Yeah.
The authorship aspect. And I forget which documentary it was now that I was watching about Demy this week, but one of his actors says, like, he's very, you know, he's very open to talking to you and everything, but he's very strict about what he wants in his movies. Like, he does not want suggestions from his actors. You're going to do what
I
he says.
I didn't hear about
that. Yeah. I think it was in the World of Demy movie
okay,
that Varda
yeah.
made about him. Where they go over all his movies, but yeah, one of the actors says that, and I was like, I can kind of see that too. Like,
yeah.
all of his movies feel super precise.
Oh,
and
yeah.
that's
yeah.
kind of how it has to be with musicals, though, especially like
oh,
you have to have like it's based on choreography. I mean,
oh, that's true.
Like you have to follow what the director
yeah.
wants. I mean, may like he
or
probably wasn't as bad as some directors are, but like at like at being harsh with his actors or actresses or anything like that, but. Like, you definitely see that.
No, you can
movies.
Be nice to your actress and still be harsh
yes.
about what you want. In the, you know, because
yeah.
at the end of the day, people are going to blame you if the movie's bad or not.
Oh,
you know?
Yes, they will.
But
what about you, Luke? You brought the question up. Do you see any similarities?
Similarities? I mean, it's a tough. I mean, I'd say more of a similarity just between Varda and Marker. I think... they encapsulate their documentaries are kind of like they film the world in like a sort of similar way, but they're like similar in that they film people a lot, like the way they kind of film people,
mm.
but they're also different because Marker, you know, more films like I feel like he films like more culture, you know,
mm.
of different countries, while Varda wants to film the people,
okay,
which I find
I like
is interesting.
I like that. She's more interested in unique people, like
yeah.
almost the faces.
Yeah, like you can easily see that in, you know, like Gleaners and I and Faces Places and then like...
I mean, we'll talk about this later, but I even noticed a lot of that aspects in Cleo.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, with just the filming different faces, like... Marker,
Marker's
yeah.
definitely
but,
like
that,
too.
Yeah.
At least in Sans Soleil, for sure. He's definitely
mm-hmm.
like that.
I
and in Far From
he's
Vietnam,
definitely more
he's definitely
broad,
like
though.
That, too. But
he's more... Varda is more focused on the individual. Marker's more focused on like everyone, like more
culturally
the society.
Like
basically,
he
yeah.
likes talk. He likes talking about time a lot and like
yeah.
how time affects and like the different views of time and that other cultures have. Like he is
yeah,
definitely
yes,
he
yes.
definitely likes talking about different cultures and how they view the world a lot more
yes.
than the individual.
So,
sure.
Yeah, Varda's more interested in how individuals maybe view
yeah.
the world in different places.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. And I really that's why I like Marker a lot though, is because I really
no, that's why
yeah,
I like
vibe
both of them.
With.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely. But I really do vibe with how Marker's filming. Just trying to show a different culture's perspective because he's very, very.
But he's
good
also
at that.
Very honest. Like it's only his like, and that's another thing
yeah,
that
no,
I find
yeah.
similar with them is, both of them film documentaries, but very personal documentaries.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
They're not even trying to hide it, right? Like, they're not even trying to hide, like, they're not trying to hide under objectivity of, oh, see, this is just a straight factual documentary.
Oh, yeah.
They can't, and especially Markerbleed, this is like, there's always going to be some kind of subjectivity, some kind of personality in it. So,
yeah. I mean, yeah,
you might as well show, and they both show, especially Varda shows it a lot,
yeah,
but they both do.
Varda legitimately, like, will, like, have random cuts in her documentary of her, like, filming.
Yes, yes,
like,
yes,
yeah,
yes,
it's
yeah.
like, it's amazing.
And I haven't even seen The Cleaners in a while, but I saw a quote from it recently, and I saw you watched it.
Oh, yeah.
But apparently there's a quote in it, something like, this documentary is about my right hand filming my left hand, or something like that.
Oh, yeah, 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 because she basically takes her camera, and she, like,
goes
films
over,
her
yes,
hand.
Yeah. And she's like, it's aging or something.
Yeah.
She, I don't recognize it or something. Right?
Yeah, it's really cool.
But you can see that same theme of passage of time in
yeah.
two totally different ways, right?
Yeah.
Like, Varda's focused more on the individual, like you were saying. And Marco focuses it, like you're saying, more how different cultures view
yeah.
it.
And yeah. And like
how it affects those different, how it affects, he does go over how that affects the individual too, obviously,
yeah.
but he does do it more as like
yeah.
a communal thing.
And speaking of like, it makes me remind me of what I've, the Siberia doc, Letter from Siberia, what Barker does to like infuse like a not, he's trying to be as, he's not trying to be like objective about it. Was like he made like an ad for reindeer in it. It was like,
oh, I love that.
It was
oh,
so funny. Like,
horror too. It
like,
looks like a legit commercial for a little bit.
Yeah, I was like, what the heck?
And then like Criterion's putting commercials in their documentary.
Yeah, and he'll cut to like an animated like, you know, section of
oh,
like,
no, yes.
Like, are you like, it's like Wes Anderson in The French Dispatch. Like, just like a randomly cut to an animated part of it, which is interesting, which I find really cool. But
and that kind of just ties into why this whole phrase French New Wave actually does kind of make sense to describe a lot of these directors is
yeah.
they were very free going and using different kind of forms.
Yeah.
Right? Like with Cleo, that we're going to talk about later, she all of a sudden cuts to a silent movie scene.
Oh, yeah.
Remember? I mean, it kind of feels natural because they're watching a projection
yeah.
in the movie, but you know, at the same time, there's a silent a bit movie in the movie.
yeah. And with Godard in Korea, which
yeah,
just randomly showing up, but yeah, I guess.
So, anything else to add, Luke? Between
I mean,
or similarities? Well, you didn't talk about Resnais a lot.
Yeah, Resnais. Yeah,
in terms of,
he does kind of have that documentary feel, especially when I think about Resnais, I think about the opening of Hiroshima Mon Amour.
Yeah,
like that opening,
oh,
like
yeah.
is insane.
Oh yes,
with the museum.
Street,
yeah.
He does such a good job.
Yeah,
I feel
yeah,
like,
the
unlike all the others, he does a good job of like being very like dreamy. You know.
Okay.
A lot, you know, last year, Mary Beth, legitimately, the whole thing is, like, dreamy.
It
I mean,
is,
come
yeah.
on now.
There's, like, these long tracking shots.
Yeah, it's just like, all feels like it's just free-flowing in a dream, and then, like,
and a lot
the
of
opening of Hiroshima
and,
War is also.
And, like, the word I think about when, at least when I think about his movies are very open.
Oh, yeah.
To, like, I don't know how to describe that, but
I feel what you're saying, yeah.
Maybe the less, like, I see his personality the less in his movie, less than maybe some of the other ones that are more direct about it.
Yeah. Yeah, I can see that. I mean, it's kind of hard to though to stack up.
They're more ambiguous,
three.
I guess. That's what I kind of mean more.
Because like the other three like show it like very heavily.
Yes.
So
yes.
I mean, it's kind of hard
yes.
to stack up. But I do what you're. I see what you're saying. Yeah.
His movies feel more ambiguous, kind of free flowing almost. But,
yeah, I see what you're saying, but it's kind of hard to talk about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you know, like we were saying, and I guess we'll probably talk about this next week too. But we'll have to come back to the French New Wave at some point.
Oh
later.
Yeah, that's why I called it intro.
Intro.
Yeah. Basically,
yeah.
Because,
you know. We're talking about Resnais. We're not even going to talk about him that much overall, right?
And I do want, like, they, at least the Left Bank directors, from what I understand, didn't really like being put into the French New Wave. Like, they didn't like being grouped in with everyone else. And you kind of get that, because, like, we've been talking about, or at least I have been this whole time, I was very honest at the very beginning of the series. Like, I didn't know what the French, like, I didn't, whatever I thought of French New Wave, I thought of, like, Godard, maybe Varda. Or, like, Godard and Truffaut mostly, though, you know? Like, you think of a few specific things, and then you think they're all the same.
Yeah.
And that's why they didn't like being put into that, because they're like, we're not the same, we're not
the
same people.
Yes,
like, we're like whenever you put something in like that, they like everyone just automatically thinks, like, they make the same type of movie.
Yes.
Oh,
whenever
yeah.
it's not that, it's like they are the same type of, like, auteur directors. Like, they make different movies, but they all share that worship. That's why they're grouped into the French New Wave. But I mean, it's just like I don't really like calling them French New Wave, honestly. Like I don't really like adding
it
them
actually
into
makes
French
more
Wave,
sense
but
it makes more sense to use the term French New Wave just for the Cahier Du Cinema Group,
kind of. Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
But at the same time,
it doesn't make sense for everyone.
You have to put Varda in.
Yeah, it makes sense for everyone. But
if you think of French New Wave as an influential group, you know, a group that impacted other groups, other places that have started to have, you know, we want to be, you know, a Taiwanese new cinema, that kind of thing, or an Indian New Wave. You know,
yeah,
that's what a lot of people are basing on, is how they base this group on. So
that's why I do also like grouping them in with the French New Wave, but it's just you have to be careful when you use that word. Yeah.
Like, what do you mean by it?
You have to explain what you mean by it, I feel. Or it needs to be explained better, at least, because a lot of people just say French New Wave and then leave it at that.
And a lot of it's a cool name. I mean, it's a cool title for a group, you know, French New Wave, like. It makes you want to watch
New Wave of Vogue or whatever, isn't that what it's called?
Nouvelle Vogue. Nouvelle Vogue. Okay. Yeah, fun to say. I mean,
But
I guess it's a good time to go to break. After the break, we'll be discussing our three movies that we picked for today. Those will be La Jetée, The Umbrellas of Cherbourg, and Cléo 5-7. So see you then. Welcome back. So to start this off, I guess we'll be starting off with the first movie we're going to be talking about, which is La Jetée. If you don't know what La Jetée is, it's directed by Chris Marker. What year did it come out?
62.
Yeah. 62, yeah. And essentially, it's a 30-minute movie about basically this guy is basically sent back in time. It's kind of complicated. It's like he gets set back in time, and then he meets a woman which he sees in his basically his like dreams. He like has a picture of her face, but so to start off, we highly recommend it, by the way. Everyone needs to watch this
and
movie.
And honestly, I'll be honest, it was kind of funny because it makes me think of how good the movie is to some degrees. I was watching you try to describe the movie in like two sentences. It's basically impossible to describe the movie.
Oh, man.
Two sentences,
it's like,
it could be like you know, a guy just thinking about an ex-lover he had, or a woman from his past, right? Yeah. But it's also a sci-fi movie because for some reason they need his memories from the past.
It's time travel. He's also a slave. I mean, like,
You know, there's nuclear. I think it's a nuke.
A nuke got dropped on Paris and destroyed it.
But let's get it, because I've been excited to talk because Marker's one of my all-time favorites.
He's great, man.
Yeah, Sans Soleil was a huge movie for me in terms of, like, there's certain movies, you know, you're like, even when you've watched a lot of movies, there are certain movies you watch and you're like, you can do this with movies.
Oh,
you
know? For sure, yeah.
And La Jetée was definitely that, but definitely Sans Soleil. And I kind of think of them, partly because they're on the same Criterion DVD or Blu-ray, but it's for other reasons, too. I just think about the creativity of the form, right? Like, making... Let's just talk about, we'll keep it La Jetée, like just taking just pictures and making it feel like an exciting sci-fi movie at parts, a romantic movie at parts. Yeah.
And the fact that it was basically a mistake because he really couldn't afford all the rolls of film except for one, basically. So he basically just made it without, and it works better than I think it would. Because, I mean, I feel like it perfectly, like, does encapsulates the feeling of, like, the memory, basically. Disjointed memories.
Yes.
And it's crazy how he didn't mean it to be that way, but it worked so much better than if he did just like a regular movie.
Yeah, I definitely agree.
I think a regular movie would have been awesome as well, because just the way that he made the sci-fi world look in the still frames, like it would have been pretty cool seeing that come to life with just,
I'm not
like
saying
it'd
be bad or
frames
anything,
a second,
but I still think it's bad. I think what he did was better than what he could have done.
I feel like it just works better.
No, and because what you're saying is
it works better for what
the
he
form
wants.
Of the movie, the way it's actually made, just feels like part of the story of the movie itself, right?
Yeah.
He's trying, like, it's about a movie about a guy trying to go back in time because they need his memories, right?
Yeah.
And over time, like almost when you first go back to find a memory, you only get little glimpses of it, right?
But, yeah.
in this case, the more he thinks about it, the memories get deeper and clearer, you know. But that's kind of what I like about it. I guess, I mean, we're going to spoil it, so, because...
Yeah, I mean, come on.
Hopefully you watch it. It's only 28 minutes.
Please watch it.
Yeah.
So, please watch it.
And for me, the best part of the movie is the museum scene, where they're...
So hypnotizing.
Yes, it's... Yes,
yes.
Exactly. That's a good way to put it, yes, because
yeah.
It's like, oh, finally, we're here, and his memory is like the memory he wanted, right? They're roaming through the museum.
Yeah.
But at the same time, like, it's just very good imagery, because they're in an actual museum with prehistoric animals.
Yeah.
And... they like, at least when I watch it, they feel like prehistoric animals just with them, right? Because they think they're in the now, while all those creatures are in the past. But we know all these things are in the past.
Yeah.
Their memories and the animals, you know. So they're just part of the museum almost. I love that aspect of it.
I think my favorite part is definitely the ending, though. I feel like that's like the best part of the movie. That's
okay,
like,
okay, we'll save that. We gotta save that.
Yeah, we'll save that.
Unless do we have? I feel like. What do you have? What else do you like about the movie?
Well,
you called it one of the best sci-fis of all time.
It is one of the best sci-fi movies of all time. I mean, it's inspired so many other sci-fi, like just so much genres in sci-fi. Like basically, the entire cyberpunk genre owes its existence to this almost. It's just, even just the scientist with the goggles, man. Like, the glasses are so iconic, and there has been so much sci-fi that has had evil scientists look exactly like this, and they've had experiments look exactly like the eye, like the, like
pads,
the little, the pads on the yeah, the maxi pads on the eye.
And
to go back into the past. And then it's like, it's inspired so much time travel in movies, just in general.
Okay,
like, this is, it's probably the best time travel movie of all time.
I've
seen quite a few. I've seen quite a few.
I mean, 2001's kind of a time travel movie. Your it is basically time travel. I mean, the first half to the second, or the first third to the second third, is literally a huge time jump.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
But I mean,
no. But the reason that this one, I like this one a lot, just because Marker knows how to film. Like we already said in this episode, he is fascinated with time, and with how to film time, and the way that he films time in this is. It makes me because the way that I remember things, you don't remember things in motion most of the time. You remember them in glimpses, like in
images,
like you have a snapshot in your mind. Like that's the whole thing. Like people say, like there's just this corny stuff sometimes of like in the Office, like whenever they're going to get married or something, they take snapshots in the save in their mind. It's like it's like just everyone remembers in like frames in their mind.
Yeah.
Especially since, not to cut you off, but like even if you just think of having a little picture, right? The picture brings back so many memories, right?
Yeah.
Once you see the picture of, you know, maybe a memory from your past, the image is what spurs that on, right?
Yeah.
And in this movie, it kind of uses that to his advantage, right? Like,
it does.
A literally image of this girl he keeps going back to because it spurs all these memories from it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
For him, like the ending, the moment of his death, that's what he keeps going back to.
Yeah, and it's also just the pairing of, like, I think the first time you see the man, like, there's, like, a heartbeat.
Yes.
And that heartbeat plays, like, based on how he's feeling the whole time in the movie.
No,
like, if it's, like, something super dramatic going on, it gets very fast.
Yes.
If it's something nice, it's going slower.
No, I'm so glad you mentioned the heartbeat, because that's one of my favorite parts of watching it this time, is not only the simplicity of the images, but the simplicity of the soundtrack plays to its advantage of, like, when you, like with the heartbeat. There'll be a very calm moment, and the next moment you see the scientist, and the heartbeat gets very fast.
Yeah.
And that's all you need. You need a fast, pumpy heartbeat, and all of a sudden you feel the tension of scientists around you, and you feel the whispers. You know, all you need is little whispers, and like it feels like
those little
scary
whispers. It's so creepy,
right? Like,
and it's the way he films it, because it's so shadowy.
Yes.
Yeah.
You could, it feels like they're in some dark underground place.
Yes. And
right?
That's what it's supposed to feel like, because they are in a dark underground place.
And
it's
did that
pretty great,
without any motion too.
Yeah,
it's crazy.
No motion. It's just a good cutting at the right time.
Yeah.
Man.
And it goes to show that you don't, like movies aren't, like, yes, they are motion pictures. That's what a movie is.
Yeah.
It's a motion picture. But you can make interesting movies without having to have motion. Like, I feel like there have been a lot of directors that have shown that, but this is definitely one at the forefront.
Yeah.
Like, isn't 20 frames a second, isn't it a Kiarostami, right?
24 frames
like that,
yeah,
kind
that's
of.
Yeah, film is 24 frames. At least that's how it's shown in the theater. 24.
Yeah,
frames 24
frames
a
second.
Well, but he has a movie called 24.
Yeah,
yeah,
he does.
Yeah,
yes,
yeah,
yeah. That's why he titled it.
Yeah,
yeah,
I was confused.
I don't know. It's just really cool. It's just a really unique way of doing it. And
I guess a way to put that is, it makes you think about how films are literally just pictures in motion, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
And this is just a slower version of that same thing, right? Instead of 24 frames per second, it could be one frame per 5 seconds.
Yeah.
But it's still a movie, right? It's still frames in motion.
I think, speaking of this, we need to shout out Thomas's.
Dude, yes, his
review.
Yeah, I was about to do that.
Yeah.
That's a great
hold
review.
Hold on,
it's a great review.
Let me get it up. Hold on 1 second.
Okay.
It's a great review. I mean, shout out Thomas, dude.
Shout
out
Thomas,
his
brother.
His review on Letterboxd is this film does more with 1 to 2 frames per second than most can do with 24.
Okay.
Which
that's
is
true.
Honestly
that's
right,
saying,
yeah.
Yes. And it kind of goes back to, and we're going to talk about this later to some degree with Demi, but in terms of just keeping it to this movie is, what I gravitate towards is movies that are more simpler, they can also feel more powerful because they almost hold back on it, right? It's not trying to show you everything.
Yeah.
It's actually hiding most of it, and it's trying to make you, trying to make you an active participant in the movie, right?
Yeah.
And by showing so little, right? In this case, literally so little frames, right? Compared to a normal movie, somehow it feels more powerful than a movie that, like, you know, the review you just read has a lot of frames in it, right?
Yeah,
it's
also just the thing of, like, how we talked about with Celine and Julie with Rivette last week, and how he doesn't tell you what to think. He just shows you images and lets you figure it out for yourself, basically. Like, that is a lot of what Marker is. Like, he does explain in his writings and stuff what he thinks, he's thinking, but it's just different.
I read this quote that he had where he said something like, a good film, even if it asks the right question, even if it makes you ask good questions, a good film, you'll also be able to find some answers in the movie, too.
Yeah.
And like, but he's not going to tell you what the answers are.
Yeah.
That'll be somewhere in the movie, right? And it's all up for interpretation.
It is,
as well.
Yeah.
But do you guys have anything else to add for the logic? I mean,
well, just
I
the ending that
movie,
Luke
like...
that Luke wanted to talk about. The ending is one of the best.
It's just a perfect
ending
because like
it is a perfect ending.
The way he just like I love how it just ends right after it. There's nothing, no theatrics after it. He ends it there, which is perfect. And it's just such a great reveal of how he reveals it.
I need to read another Marker quote that I found that I thought perfectly matches this movie specifically. I'll read the quote first. I think that any reasonably long memory, in parentheses, like every collection, is more structured than it seems at first sight. And it kind of makes me think of this movie because every time he goes back to the memory, literally, it becomes a little more structured. Right?
It does, yeah.
And I just think, and well, I guess because Blake, spoiler, we're going to talk about our favorites from the French New Wave next week. And spoiler, Blake is doing another Marker movie, so we're going to talk about it more next week for sure.
Yeah, we will.
But that theme of memories and time, right, and how they're related is just a huge theme in a lot of his movies.
Yeah.
And that makes... And just to do that in a short 28-minute sci-fi movie, but still make you ponder all these questions like it was 2001 A Space Odyssey or something, you know?
Like it was 3 hours.
Yeah.
Honestly, I would have watched it if it was 3 hours. Like, imagine a 3-hour movie just like that. I would watch that.
I would too, honestly.
That'd be sick.
It'd be very interesting. It'd be interesting to watch a Marker movie, like a 3-hour long Marker movie. I don't think he ever wanted to do movies like that. It'd be interesting if he ever did. If he ever would have.
He could have.
He could have if he wanted to, yes.
Yeah. But I guess that takes us into our next movie, The Umbrellas of Cherbourg, directed by Jacques Demy. If you're not aware of Umbrellas of Cherbourg, it's basically a musical where they legitimately sang the entire time. Every dialogue is sung. And it's basically about it's about a girl. She's the daughter of a owner of an umbrella shop, and basically, she has a love affair with this mechanic called Guy or Gay or Gee or whatever.
I think the English translation just says Guy.
Yeah, the English translation says Guy.
And basically, he has to go off to war, and basically, she has to choose between him and a wealthy diamond dealer that promises to, you know, help her family and stuff.
Yeah.
Just to explain my thoughts on the movie, I love this movie. I love Demy in general. I'm a huge Jacques Demy stan, which
nice.
Not everyone is, obviously, but I mean, he's a director which he's not gonna make you like think. He's not gonna make you think like a lot of directors like as in deep as in cinema as a lot of directors, but like his movies are just like I can just sit through any of his movies and just have a blast with them, and they're all so fun. And Well, I guess you could say this one is not as fun as a lot of his other movies because it's kind of sad. But what I love about this movie is like the colors, the characters. I love how it almost has like an opera feeling with the dialogue all being sung. I love the ending, even though Damien Chazelle kind of ripped it off for La La Land. But you know, we're not gonna get it yet.
Homage,
man, maybe, but
if you would have liked La La Land, you would be calling
homage. It better,
I actually do like La La Land. I don't know.
You but, you, the way you were talking about it before, you were like hating on
well,
it.
Well, I have lost respect for it after I saw that thing. It's essentially, I guess it is Jacques Demy love letter, and maybe I should like that, but I don't know why I don't. But anyway, let's talk about Umbrellas of Cherbourg. You know,
because the singing and dancing in La La Land sucks.
Okay.
Whenever you watch Umbrellas of Cherbourg, especially
Young Girls
of
Rochefort, the dancing in that movie is insane. But really, it's just a beautiful movie. Umbrellas of Cherbourg is, and I just love everything about it, pretty much everything about it. But I'm gonna open up to you guys. What are your thoughts on it?
No, so what you were getting at of him like making movies that don't make you think, like he actually has so many quotes about that where, like, even just in that documentary that we've been talking about this whole time, one of the ones I wrote down was, "I'm always looking for emotion, which is why I say I'm more sentimental than intellectual. I attach a lot of importance to emotion."
Yeah.
And then he also has another one like later on talking about how he doesn't want to make like. He doesn't want to make his characters like someone like Godard would make, like where they're so like intellectual, like he just finds that stuffy and he doesn't want to do that. That's why he makes his female characters like simple, pretty girls. I mean, some people don't like that for sure, but I really liked it in Umbrellas of Cherbourg. I didn't love Umbrellas of Cherbourg the first time I watched it, but watching it this time, I respect it a lot more. The singing dialogue the first time was super jarring and really weird. And this time watching it, I just thought it worked better,
honestly.
It's just
beautiful and cinematic, I feel like.
Yeah, and another thing with Demy is, like, his first two movies, Lola and Bay of Angels, were in black and white.
Oh, yeah.
And one reason I like his later movies, or the ones I've seen, is because he is just a director that's made for color.
Oh, yeah.
Like, Lola is a great movie. That's the one I've seen, like, of his black and white ones. It's a great movie. But you can tell that Jacques Demy wants his world to be colorful. Even in Lola, you can tell that he wanted there to be color in Lola, probably. And that's one reason why he wouldn't do this, like, Umbrellas of Cherbourg in black and white.
Although, I would say that having watched Bay of Angels, it feels like black and white would fit more in that movie because it's more depressing and and more, you know, just kind of.
Lola kind of is too.
Lola's kind of depressing, but.
But like.
But I mean, a lot of his movies are like Lola.
But it's nowhere near as much as Bay of Angels, though. Okay. Which is what I'm referring to. But yeah, do you. What do you think?
Okay, I guess I'll frame it like. What I first think about the movie is obviously the music, but I think of Michel Legrand too, the composer.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Because, like, especially in Umbrellas of Cherbourg and kind of Young Girls, and both of those movies, especially is. To me, you almost can't separate the two.
He's
basically just as important as the director is in that movie because of how, especially in Umbrellas, how important the music is.
Oh yeah.
You know, like the movie is set around, like the music is the script.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
But even more than the script, because it's bringing actually live emotion to the movie as well. Yeah. It's not just words on a paper. It's actually part of the movie, the sound.
Yeah.
Like literally, like you said, there's everything's all singing, because. None of the actors are actually singing, right? It's basically a soundtrack.
Yeah, like, and this is also why I forgot what I was gonna say. Okay, well, you can continue. I forgot what I was gonna say.
No, I was basically saying that's what I think about when I think about the movies. Michel Legrand as well.
And it's crazy how they legitimately, like in the documentary, they said they made the score, but they couldn't, like, because of like how it was constructed. However long the score is, they literally had to film to the second, basically.
Yeah.
Which I thought was super interesting, because I've never seen a movie that it basically films around the score. Like, that's crazy.
Yeah, I remember what I was going to say now. The reason I actually like that Demy is included in the French New Wave is because of the way he did musicals. Like, he did musicals in, like, basically a completely new way. At least with Umbrellas of Cherbourg, because I don't recall a musical before this that has had all-singing dialogue. And he even talks about how the struggle with that is that you have to have people invested in it at the very beginning. Because if they aren't invested from the first line, then they aren't going to like it.
Yeah.
And so that's why he starts it out like with all that brass at the very beginning. He starts out very energetic, because you have to get that feeling in there.
Great opening.
To make people buy into it, you know?
Yeah.
Like, he thought about it a lot, and he really loves musicals, and you can just tell that whenever you watch Umbrellas of Cherbourg.
He just, you know he's just having a blast when he's building these. Like,
yes.
Just, like, putting all these compositions together, but, really elevates the film movie to another level too is Catherine Deneuve. She does, like, she's amazing in it, and the way she portrays, like, the conflict in herself whilst just singing, basically, which she isn't really even singing, she's like lip syncing.
No, yeah, that's crazy, dude.
Like, it's you kind of don't realize how, like, hard that is to do until you think about it. You're like, wow.
I mean, I didn't even realize that they were lip syncing.
Yeah, me neither. Yeah,
or lip syncing until like I watched that documentary, and then I was like, oh wow.
Yeah, but...
and that's because Jacques Demy told them that they had to sing all their lines anyway, and he was saying how awful it was when they're singing their lines. It's like, it's so bad. Oh, okay. But then it always sounds beautiful in post because they get the actual singers.
Yeah, but do you have any, like, did you find any problems with it, though? I mean...
Problems? It's more... And this is why I don't want to sound too mean or anything. No, I'm not going to sound mean, because I actually really respect him. Like, and that's... It's more of a personal thing. Like...
Yeah.
This type of movie... it's just not my thing, really.
That's
like,
fair,
the musical,
yeah.
And this is kind of just the way I feel about a lot of movies in general, is a movie that uses music too much kind of just gets on my nerves sometimes, you know, like, and because we were talking about I wanted to mention in relation to Marker from earlier, right, where it's like he wants your mind to do a lot of the thinking in terms of making part of the reason why the movie is good is because your thoughts are going along with the movie, but especially in, and I don't feel like this way with all of Demy's movies I've seen, like, there actually is some interesting kind of themes to think about in Donkey Skin or Lola, but especially with Umbrellas, where it's all based on almost a formal aspect of it, right? Like, can we actually do a musical that's all singing?
Yeah.
And because of that, you could say, you know, the story suffers. It's a very simple story.
Even though
they're, like, we'll talk about the Algeria stuff, where themes are interesting, right? But just the way it's told in story form, to me, it just kind of seems very simplistic, but that's not bad. It's just simplistic. And because the music is doing a lot of carrying, at least in my opinion, you know, it feels less like a movie and more just like a song almost. Which,
I mean, it's a musical.
It's a musical. I don't know. I guess it's not my thing. That's what I'm trying to say. That's not
my
thing.
No, that's fair.
That's completely fine.
The type
it's
of
very film, if you don't like musical, or if you're not a fan of musicals to begin with, and then you go into watching a one where there's just like all singing and all the dialogue, it's like, it's,
I kind of wanted
weird
to mention this at least because it's, I don't know if you guys have seen a lot of Bollywood movies. I've seen some.
I've only seen a few.
I've seen like
but
one.
Demi's movies actually more young girls of Rochefort, less Umbrellas of Cherbourg. But you know, a lot of people, even whether they like them or hate them, a lot of people, one of the aspects of Bollywood movies is just the random songs in the movie. Like, people go to watch Bollywood movies for the songs. They go to watch the composers or the composer or the songwriters, right?
Yeah. Even and it has its place. It has its place because
I like the Bollywood
movies I've actually watched.
And if you do it well, like any form, if you do it well, like you were saying before we started, if it's a good movie, it's a good movie. You know, it doesn't matter how it's done. But the reason why I brought that up is I kind of like the way Bollywoods feel more disjointed, feel more random. There'll be like a random action scene that's all, you know, over the top, and then a random song, you know? Versus this one just feels kind of, you know, the same the whole time.
Yeah.
And like, I really thought at one point when watching this, because I didn't know the movie was all song, I thought the absence scene was going to be the scene where all of a sudden they just start talking normally.
Oh, really?
You know, I was like, okay, this is going to be crazy. Like, all of a sudden we're just going to have, like, just normal talking because, you know, the music is gone.
Nope.
When it keeps going, I'm like, okay, I mean, it's more impressive, you know? It's like watching a sport that you don't necessarily like watching, but you respect the quality it takes or, you know, the skill it takes to be good at that sport.
I think that's very fair. Yeah, I think that's a very fair opinion, like.
I think the story, it is kind of simple, but I do think that the Algeria stuff does play into it quite a bit because
it does.
He did that. He did that on purpose, where he didn't want to mention Algeria because he obviously didn't want people coming home from the war to like actually have to think about that because
it's
so fresh on their minds. Yeah. That's one of the things in the documentaries that Demi actually talks about, was how fresh on the mind, or maybe it wasn't Demi that was talking about that, but someone else, but how fresh on the minds that of these 20 and 30 year olds that got drafted over into Algeria, how fresh that would have been on their minds, and then just coming back and watching a movie where it kind of
represents
them.
Her choosing a rich guy after the young guy goes to war kind of feels like representation of lot of those soldiers might have feeling coming back and being felt like France had chosen, you know.
Yeah, and one of my favorite scenes is whenever he's leaving on the train, like he just got drafted and they're walking, all alone. Like yes, there's literally like just him, like it's just him that got drafted, I guess. He's just leaving by himself.
Such a Demi moment.
Yeah, and that's something that they mention. It's like the draft process in France for Algeria and just war in general is a very lonely experience.
Yeah.
Like, yes, you have people that you fight with.
Especially the Algerian War. And, like, yeah, especially the Algerian War. I don't want to get too much into politics or anything, but, like, a lot of people in France also hated that war.
Yeah.
Especially by the end, right?
Yeah.
And there was a similar experience with American veterans coming back from Vietnam in terms of however you feel about the war, those soldiers coming back, a lot of them felt hated.
Yeah,
they came back.
And you see that in this movie, too, where where he's going out for alcohol, and he gives them a big bill, and he says, oh, you guys always give us your big bills, and then he basically just runs them out of the store because he doesn't feel welcome anywhere after he comes back.
Yeah.
And I just think, it's so far separated from us now that we can see that but not feel it, but I think back then, like, that definitely was probably probably connected.
And I remember, because we keep mentioning this documentary, so I'll link it in the description, but that Criterion documentary, The Once Upon a Time in Umbrellas, they mentioned that part as well, I'm pretty sure, of this movie being one of the first to kind of address Algeria. Even if you're, like, you kind of have to know the history if you're actually watching the movie, but for all, like you're saying, people watching at the time, they all knew the history, right?
It was very fresh.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
No, and that's also...
And that is something I respect about it, too.
Yeah.
But even then, like, it's addressing it by not addressing it, right? It's like, it's the elephant in the room
that's why I like the absence scene, too, because they basically don't... I mean, they have, like, I think she reads, like, a letter in there, but they literally don't talk about anything, like, any, like, got Guy at all, or whatever.
What do you guys think about him using the main character from Lola?
No, see, that's what I was actually about to mention, is how... Because I actually don't think Jacques Demy is a hopeless romantic. Like, it kind of seems like that sometimes whenever you watch his movies. But Lola, because Cassard is a character in Lola. He's the guy that doesn't get her.
Yeah.
That doesn't get her at the end and is walking away.
And I love the scene where, like, Roland Cassard mentions the movie Lola. And, like, he goes back to the place from Lola.
Yeah.
And, like, dude, that's such a cool...
It's
like,
a cool shot, dude.
I love that.
Cool shot.
It's like oh, shit. But
I kind of want to mention another thing. Just watching some of Demi's movies is, in a lot of his movies, I've noticed he loves the single mother with the daughter.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
But like the single mother will also like a single mother will have her own crush, and then the daughter will also have a crush on a guy, and sometimes they relate, sometimes they don't. It's like
he's kind of
comparing them. Like he'll compare the mother and daughter to the people they like almost.
Yeah.
And I like that.
Yeah. But it's honestly interesting.
You definitely see that in Young Girls of Russia a lot.
Yes.
Yeah. Demy pretty much has his own cinematic universe because, like, I don't know if you guys noticed, but, like, well, you guys haven't seen Bay of Angels, so the Bay of Angels girl was the girl that Michelle... apparently, I watched a video on this, and so in Model Shop, you remember Mikkel from Lola, right? He ran off with Lola.
Yeah.
And basically... it's real Model Shop that he ran off, left Lola and ran off with another woman.
Oh my God.
And it turns out that woman is the one from Bay of Angels.
What?
So pretty much he's like, because the girl Bay of Angels mentions Mikkel. He basically has this whole cinematic universe, which I think is really interesting.
He does. I mean,
It's like,
where's Donkey's skin coming?
I guess, at least in one way, a good example of that is just the way he uses Danube Bazal's movies.
Yeah.
She's almost a very similar character in a lot of her movies. This is more Young Girls of Rochester, but literally, like, you know, the feminine ideal. What is that? That kind of thing.
Oh,
I'm pretty sure it's in the Umbrellas of Rochester documentary as well, where I think Varda mentions that he saw Danube as that feminine ideal, and that's why he went through so much.
Yeah. I think that was, And one thing that, well, I know that they asked in that documentary if living together caused a lot, if they influenced each other's movies just because they were living together and were married to each other for so long, and she said no. But I mean, at least for Demi, you kind of see it because he married Varda whenever she was a single mother.
Yes.
You know, like that, like So maybe because he was dating her and married her eventually and lived with her for so long, he just respects
that
woman,
dude,
that woman a lot more because he knows what it takes, or he's seen what it takes for a woman to live like that.
But yeah, I mean,
that could be a good transition.
I guess so.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's
to
a good
Cleo,
you just yeah
you're
brought up
welcome.
Varda.
So our next, the last movie we'll be talking about today is one of my favorite movies of all time. And
Wait, okay. Before we talk about Cleo, though, I just realized we didn't talk about the ending
yes, actually, you know,
of Umbrellas.
I
We
let
have
me
to mention the ending.
yes,
the end, yeah, ending. Well, I was going to talk about more Jacques Demy in general when it comes to endings. I
Okay,
think he's
exactly.
amazing at ending movies.
All right,
Which I
why?
don't know if you guys share the same opinion, but I love his endings because they're all
I've liked
different.
him,
But he
yes,
just
I have a
I think
lot
he
of them.
just I just like him because he can make him depressing, he can make him sad, he can make him hopeful, he can make him happy. He's just good at all types of endings. And I just think it's kind of hard to compare them all, bring up a similar point on why they're all good, but they all just work.
Yeah.
And especially in Umbrellas of Cherbourg, the snow and basically, I think he doesn't even say very much gay. Or guy. I don't want to call him gay, but
Just call him Guy.
guy,
That's what
yeah.
the English translation says.
Yeah, Guy basically doesn't barely even says a word to her, basically, because
No.
he kind of holds a grudge in a way,
Well, it's
so
just
sort of.
I mean, they moved, he moved on. I feel like that's
But do
what
you
that
think
scene
he?
says a lot, is that I think she's not as moved on as he is
Yeah.
because she's not the one that got as hurt by this as he
I
was.
guess I
He moved
yeah, I
on
see
and
what you're
got,
saying.
he
Yeah.
decided to
Yeah.
choose happiness instead of
Yes,
waiting for her
and
and being
that's
sad.
really what the ending feels like to me.
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess I didn't realize he almost is like he almost just doesn't want to see her again, basically. Just
Yeah.
because yeah, I that's actually
And
a
you
better
get that
interpretation.
because I don't
Yes.
want to see
Yeah.
my old girlfriends
Yeah.
very much after I break up, man. I don't usually want to hang out, you know? Some
Yeah.
people are different, but I don't usually want to hang out with my old
Yeah.
girlfriends, you know?
And I kind of and I just thought of this while we mentioned the gas station scene is how that relates to the train scene as well, where
Yeah.
they're both alone in both scenes,
Yeah, they
you know,
are.
like they're public places, but those are both such intimate move, you know. Obviously it's Demy, you know, he's idealizing the moment almost by
Yeah.
making them alone, but it really plays well in both scenes. Like it made me think of that scene where they're leaving the first
It's
time.
yeah.
Now she's leaving the second time alone in the gas
Yeah.
station,
And she
but
asked
this
if
time
he
he
wanted to be made it me his daughter, and he even said no. I mean,
no.
because it's not his life, you know.
Yeah,
It's
I would do the same thing if I was
and
him.
I love the way the snow feels happy and sad at the same
Yeah.
time,
Oh man,
almost, you
yeah,
know. And the
dude.
score, it's a very good ending. It's a very
Yeah, dude.
ambiguous but happy ending, right? It's not
Yeah.
just
Yeah. It's beautiful.
it's not a it's it's
It's
not just a
beautiful.
pure yeah, it's a beautiful
It's just
moment.
beautiful.
Yeah, it
Yeah.
is.
That's why I consider him not a hopeless romantic, because a hopeless romantic
Yeah,
would
no,
have
I
had
think
them
he's great.
just
He's
completely
kids.
discarding their families and running off together and stuff,
Yeah.
because they're true
No,
loves.
honestly, Young Girls at Rochester, you could say, is more a hopeless
Yeah, it's
romantic
just a
type of
little bit
movie
more.
compared
That's
to
the
this
one that I
one.
felt. That's the one where I felt it was a
Though
little
it's
bit
still
more for
amazing, though.
sure.
I mean,
Oh yeah, I still
still
really like that
it's
movie.
still I
Yeah.
still love that. But anyway, I guess we probably should get on to the next one. I mean, Cleo 5-7, one of my favorite movies of all time. I picked it for the best director category
You
on
did,
our Oscar
yeah. You
episode.
did.
So but really, this movie, it's 90 minutes, and basically in the movie it's basically just 90 minutes of it. He doesn't like she doesn't I mean she doesn't cut time at all. She basically every time she cuts it's in the moment, so it basically feels like 90 minutes, actual 90 minutes of a
Yeah.
girl's life. And the main thing, when I think about this movie, why I love it so much, is really, if you've seen the movie, you know, 45 minutes in, basically the movie changes. She takes her wig off, she's fed up, and she changes all her clothes and she walks outside, and basically the whole movie changes.
So what do you
And
mean by that? Like,
well, actually, I'm gonna get into that.
okay.
So Varda, I watched the Remembrance documentary on the Criterion Channel of Cleo 5-7, and Varda put it in probably the best words I could. That pretty much the first half of the movie, and this ties into the theme of self-importance, you know, self-image.
Yeah.
Pretty much the whole first half of the movie, everyone's seeing Cleo, her, you know, her there or the, what do you call
Tarot
it?
card reader.
Yeah, card reader. Her maid, her composers, her
Yes.
lover. Pretty much doesn't even
Yes, I see what you're
spend any
saying.
time with her. She even brought this up, which is what I may want to talk about, the mirrors. She's always looking at herself in the mirror just to get
Yeah.
self-validation of herself.
And then, you know, the audition scene happens. She's like, she doesn't want to be objectified anymore. She leaves. She like changes everything. And then she basically is like observing the second half. She looks at other people. She's observing other people.
Yes.
And basically ridding herself of the self image part of it. And
she stops looking inward so much.
Yeah.
And starts looking outward.
And it's funny. In this, Varda literally has a moment where she literally shows the how she's not doing anymore when I think it's after the short film scene where they're walking, her and the model were screaming, and a mirror dropped.
Yep.
It shattered.
I never thought about
that
when you mentioned the mirrors. That was the shot I thought of.
Yeah, and it basically, that's a great scene where it basically shows that she's she needs to stop looking inwards and you know, focus, you know, on
pretty
much,
way I view that.
Yeah.
Just to go off what you're saying is, like, when she looks at that broken mirror, to me it shows when the fact that she's about to die, she's realized this version of herself that she saw really wasn't there, kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's almost breaking apart, like, because all she sees is death coming up. Like, you know, she thinks she's about to die from cancer.
Yeah.
Or she's about to have this diagnosis of cancer. And that kind of gets me, I guess I'll just get my thoughts on the movie.
Yeah.
I really like the, that's a good way, I didn't think of it as a halfway turning point.
Oh, yeah.
Mark.
It's like, it's legitimately 45
yes, it
minutes
is like
in,
that.
Yeah.
Yes, it is like that. And especially, when she's walking alone through the cafes and stuff, all of a sudden, Varda on purpose starts, like, she starts filming the people on the side, but they're almost like posing for the camera in a way too.
Yeah.
And then at certain points, Varda also flashes back memories.
Oh, yeah.
All
the people
staring
at her,
still images. They're like, yeah, pictures.
Oh, that's
yes,
a great
yes.
scene.
It's
yeah.
a great scene, right? And it goes with what you're saying is she starts thinking about other people, you know,
yeah.
other faces, literally, a Varda theme.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I just to see that kind of maturity in a character over literally, over the movie takes place over what is it, literally an hour and a half in real time?
Yeah, it's
about
an hour and a half.
It's called 5 to 7.
Okay.
It's like
okay,
five to 6:30.
Okay,
5
to 3. I mean, it doesn't sound the same, you know. It doesn't sound as good as 5 to 7, but
no, yeah. But that's what I think about, I guess, when I think about it. So
yeah.
What
about you,
Blake?
Yeah.
No, my thoughts. So you did originally say how you think this movie would be better filmed in like color instead of black and white, because you think Varda would have just done it better that way. And I actually do like how she films this one in black and white, because
yeah,
it starts out in color with the tarot cards, and then after she turns over the death card and then it shows Cleo for the first time, it's like all black and white. It's like,
no, that was a good
it
moment.
Kind of just
yeah,
makes
I mean,
it like
moment.
It I to me it was like this is her like realizing like, oh, my world's gray, like I'm about I think like she thinks she's gonna die, like the world has lost all color.
Yes.
Unless,
yeah.
like, that's the reason I like that it's filmed in black and white. Plus, she just knows that
honestly,
it's filmed in black and white.
Honestly, I more said that, like, okay, for the themes of the movie, black and white does actually fit the movie very well. I just like how Varda films color.
Oh,
color.
Yeah,
well,
she's great
at
filming
yeah.
color.
She's, yeah, honestly,
she's great
best,
at filming
but,
everything. I
mean,
it's
yeah,
no,
right,
and
I
the
mean,
one,
on, color too,
the one critique for this movie is it does feel like her most newish new wave movie, like, it feels like her most Cahier du Cinema type movie,
or,
you know, like,
yeah.
just, it feels a lot like the actual Cahier du Cinema group
yeah, yeah.
instead
yeah,
of
yeah,
what
yeah.
she usually is known for.
But it does kind of feel like that, but at the same time, it's its own thing. I feel
oh,
like.
It definitely is its
Absolutely.
Own thing. I agree with that.
Because, I mean, do you really think any of the Cahier du Cinema could have, like,
no,
portrayed a woman that
no,
way?
No, exactly. That's
like,
why
no.
it's, that's why this is one of the better movies, like, just about how a woman would feel just in general. Whenever they have something like this anxiety. Like, my mom went through this whenever she had, like, breast cancer. Like, she literally had to wait for, like, a week for their diagnosis to come back, and she didn't get, like, much sleep at all, because you're waiting to see if you have cancer. Like, that's
yeah,
huge,
that
man.
Anxiety.
Like, that
yeah,
it's,
can,
like, a lot of anxiety, yeah. and it's just, like, one of the funniest characters in this movie is just apparently this doctor's just driving around town everywhere, like, telling people they have cancer, like, just on Sunday. Like, he's just driving around. He's like, oh, Cleo, yeah, you're here. You have cancer. Bye. And they just drop
okay,
off.
But it's a good news, though. The way it's shown in the movie.
Oh
yeah,
that's
like,
shown,
oh,
yeah,
you're only
yeah.
gonna you're
His
gonna need two,
yeah.
Yeah.
You only
yeah.
need two months of radiation.
Yeah,
you're good.
You're good.
No, but I should have mentioned this at the beginning. But especially what I noticed rewatching it this time was not only the bad parts, but also the good moments she has with this kind of knowledge of she might have a death sentence coming soon.
Yeah.
Right? It's not only depressing, she also has some good moments because of it.
Yeah.
And, like, the two examples I think of, one of them's at the very beginning when she's, like, first trying on, like, all the hats and stuff.
Yeah.
And she, you can tell, like, she just gets lost in the moment. Like, she starts to be aware of how much she likes doing all this, these things. Like, those, you know, the kind of, like, simple joys in life.
Yeah. And by the way,
it's, like, trying on clothes and hats, right?
Yeah.
Just want to shout in that scene, some great mirror shots in that scene.
Yes,
yeah,
yes,
that
yes.
was insane.
Also true, yes.
But,
And then the second one is the best example, I think, is that guy that comes and up to her randomly, the soldier that randomly comes up to her in the park and start, and they have this huge conversation. And she literally says to him, I would never would have done this normally, like, let it just start talking to a guy that started talking to me. But because she has this notion of, I could die at any moment, or I could die soon, she starts to take chances in life that normally she wouldn't have.
Yeah.
And I think that's like a beautiful kind of a
That's why it feels
like
Romer a lot, too, for sure.
Yes.
Yeah.
Honestly, just the way the camera moves with the character feels a lot like Romer.
Yeah, for sure.
Especially the inner mind of one character, you know?
Yeah.
Her, like, different emotions. But
what do you guys think of the audition scene?
Oh, I love that scene, dude.
Yeah.
And, dude, because I wanted to mention that scene. Specifically, the song they sing before her main song, you know?
Yeah.
Where they do, like, three different versions. They're like, they don't really like any of them. Noticing this time... Or first, do you guys remember the three different versions, or do you have a favorite?
No, I don't remember the
three. Watching this time, I remember the second version being my favorite, just because I don't know if you remember like how she moves the camera in that scene, where it's like swinging with each face almost, and you see like the maid in the background also swinging, and it's just a great moment in the movie.
Yeah,
but
because there's like three different versions of that song, and they do little bits of each version, and then she has her obviously famous song, but. That, I just wanted to mention that scene because it's a great scene.
Yeah, I mean, and I've heard actually, I don't know where I heard this from, but I hate to bring up La La Land again, but apparently it inspired the one scene in La La Land where she does the audition and like, where she like she goes into like a black space like, at the end of La La Land. Apparently that inspired it, which I mean, La La Land ripping off another Fresh New Wave movie. I mean, man, but and I'm just messing around, kind of.
Sounds like you just don't like La La Land, though, let's be honest.
Hey, I like La La Land, all right?
Well, you have a love-hate relationship with it. You remember a lot of it.
Yeah. Okay, anyway. Also, there's the silent film scene. I feel like that's an interesting one to talk about.
Oh, that's a great scene, yeah.
Yeah, crazy she got Anna, Karina, and Godard, which is, I mean, before they even, like... I guess before
they
Karina even blew up, I feel like. Godard, I feel, kind of already solidified himself.
This is already
62,
yeah.
Yeah, with Breathless.
Breathless.
But, I mean, what do you guys think... To be honest, that scene, I kind of don't... I still don't really understand, like, why she did it. Which, I'm wondering if you guys have any perspectives on that. Like, why did she
do
that?
With the whole sunglasses and everything?
Yeah, and just why she showed it in the movie. Like, was it just a show off? I mean, her...
I think it's honestly just an homage to the silent cinema.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I think they all liked it.
I always just took it as it's kind of just a fun scene.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But maybe there is a deeper meaning.
Because her friend's boyfriend is, like, a projectionist. Projectionist.
Yeah.
So they just get to go like watch a silent movie because their friend's a projectionist. You know?
Man.
I don't know. Like, do you think there's some kind of like, why do you think it's in it then?
Well, that's what I was asking you guys. I have no idea.
I always just thought it was kind of just a fun scene in the movie.
Yeah,
like,
honestly. Yeah.
What I was mentioning earlier about in terms of when you're when you have death on the mind, it can make you actually appreciate some of those simple joys in life, like going to watch a movie.
For sure.
You know.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah.
And there are a lot of little moments like that throughout the movie, too.
And I guess we forgot to talk about the model friend. She basically is, like, the opposite of her, in a way.
Yeah.
The way she is basically, she's not afraid to, you know, do... Yeah, I'm not going to say it. She's not afraid to pose nude in front of other people. While Cleo's, like, the opposite. She's, like, very, like, insecure and, like, keeps to herself. And
it
kind of shows her changing
in a way.
Yeah.
But, yeah, because she literally asks, her model friend, like, I don't know how you bear yourself open like that or something.
Oh, yeah.
Like, how you take those risks, I could never do something like that. But at the same time, I always thought that when she said that, it was kind of ironic because she is a singer at the same time.
Yeah.
And, like, that song she sings earlier, Sans Toi, I think.
Yeah.
Sans Toi. That's, you know, in a way, like, she literally starts bawling right after she sings the song, right? Because, like, But she's an artist that does it in her own way.
But in a way, she kind of, I feel like she kind of resents that. Because you remember the scene in the cab where her song starts playing on the radio? She's like, turn it off, turn it off.
Yeah,
I hate that.
Yes.
Yeah. That.
Okay, yeah. She has that dual, like, she wants to be an artist, but at the same time, she's kind of scared of showing herself.
She's insecure, basically.
And she,
I feel like this friend represents, like, her, like, changing, you know?
Yes.
Like, she's trying to lead her more to being, you know, more open and.
But that's what I like about, it's because that whole, I just like thinking of it as the death sentence, literally, the way she's viewing it, especially, right?
Yeah.
Like, she has this death sentence coming up, and because of that, you start seeing that those changes, right?
Yeah.
Like, the reason why, at least in my opinion, why she might just take, all of a sudden, when she takes off her wig and she puts on new clothes and she goes out, like you're saying, the halfway mark of the movie, it might be because of that death sentence. She's like, okay, I can't deal with this, you know? Like, I don't have enough time for this.
Like, I have to
maybe
live,
normally would have.
I mean,
that is
a lot of time.
Exactly.
Whenever people get there, that's a lot of things you hear is whenever people know they are, like, they have a time limit where they know they're going
to
die.
From
and they decide to live. Like, that's whenever they actually decide to live. Because you know, like, that's the one thing as we as humans, another thing with time, like how we were talking with Marker, it's just like we never think about time until it actually like faces us, like until we have to come face to face with a situation. Yeah, until we have to come face to face with a situation that makes us actually think of our own mortality and time in that way. It's
really like
it's just something you can't really actually grasp until it happens to you. Like we can say like we can get it, but like we won't actually get it until we're at that point. But this is like this is one thing that I think that. People like Marker and Varda are trying to get people to understand is that you should live more for the moment and live more for like these simple pleasures in life, like
because no matter what, all of us have death coming. You know, it might not be right away, but
it's coming for everyone.
Yes.
It's the only guarantee in life.
And that kind of connects at least La Jetée and Cleo is that idea of death making you think about time.
Yeah,
and vice versa, right? And the memories involved with that.
Yeah.
And both movies do those in their own way, but. Those themes feel very similar to me in both movies. At least.
Are you guys aware of the mistake in the final scene, by the way?
What do you mean mistake?
I'll tell it. I don't know if you guys have heard about, but so you know when they're walking towards the camera, basically it's like a tracking shot. They're like walking at the end.
Yeah.
It cuts.
Yeah.
Well, they look at each other.
Yeah, they look at each other. You can see a track in the background. And Varda talked about this on a Remembers documentary.
A track.
Basically, to signify where they're supposed to go.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't recognize it.
Yeah, well, it's not very long. It's, like, just right at the ending frame.
Oh, okay.
But Varda saw it, and she wanted to reshoot it. And so she actually, like, I think, like, a month later, she gets both those actors come back to that city, and she films it again. But she said she learned a lesson doing this, because it was not the same at all. Like, she could not get it right.
Hmm.
And she said in the documentary that she learned that sometimes you can't just replicate what your experiences are at that time on set, and like
you can't recreate that feeling again after, like you can't, like that's the thing with reshoots is like you can't create that feeling that the whole group of your entire film, like all like the whole crew is feeling something for this movie, because like you're almost done, this is the last scene, and then like it's really hard to replicate that emotion,
and you're almost like you almost become your character basically through the filming.
So,
I mean, just to mention, I know a movie we've all watched, Day for Night, kind of feels like that, right?
Yes,
it's like
yeah.
A movie, even the making of a movie, you're creating a little world with everyone involved.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So to try to recreate that in just some quick reshoots,
yeah,
I can see what she means by that.
Yeah.
That's cool though.
Yeah,
I didn't know
that. Interesting. So
I didn't know
that
either.
That.
Yeah.
Do you guys like that? I guess. We always have to talk about the endings.
Yeah, I guess it's
poor. Do you guys like the ending?
Of course, yeah.
Okay. And I guess I mentioned to you guys before the podcast started, but I kind of see Demi in the soldier at the end.
Yeah. You need to explain that a bit, honestly.
I just, especially compared to the guy she's apparently in love with at the beginning, like the rich...
The rich
guy who's way older than him, way older than her, that doesn't take her feelings into consideration and stuff. Like, she can't have a conversation. Like, she talks to him about her cancer, but she doesn't talk to her boyfriend, remember? Because her friend is like, why would you not talk to him about this? You know, he's supposed to love you. And she's like, I don't want to bother him with this, you know?
Yeah.
But she's willing to tell him about it, this random soldier. And she says something like, I kind of liked you, you had a calmness about you, or something.
Yeah.
And... I can't say this for sure, but I have to think that, because they were already together at this time when she made the movie.
Yeah.
So I have to think she had him in mind at least a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, I could see it.
Yeah. I mean,
yeah. Demi uses sailors in a lot of his movies.
Yes. But sailors going away, too.
Yeah, sailors
right?
going
sailors
away.
Sailors about to
yeah.
leave.
No, and sometimes it is just easier to tell your innermost, like, worries to someone you don't know. Like, that you don't know well, even.
Yeah.
Like even just a stranger.
That,
it
yeah.
is, it is, like, that's the big thing with confessionals, you know? Like, you don't have to see the person you're telling it
yeah.
to. You don't have to know who you're telling it to. You just have to confess.
Yeah.
Like sometimes you just need to get it off your chest, and you don't want someone that knows you to know what you're going through. Like, you just want to get it off
no,
your chest.
No, and that's definitely probably why she
you.
Starts
yeah.
saying all that. But at the end, I feel like she's going to end up with him.
Maybe,
she even,
yeah.
she even, I think she gives him her address or vice versa. I forget
yeah.
which way
yeah,
it is.
Yeah.
But they do give each other the numbers, basically. So
their numbers, their addresses.
Something like that. Yeah,
Snapchat.
Yeah, that's the modern day Snapchat.
I mean,
but,
Demi would do that. He'd be like, oh yeah, what's your Snapchat? And all of a sudden, but
Luke,
yeah.
I feel like you should, you're the one who picked Cleo, and as one of your, you picked this for best director too, right?
Yeah.
So, and I know you, I really like Varda too. I like her a lot.
Yeah.
But I know you love her, so.
No, oh, yeah.
End us off. Why do you like the ending? Oh, why Cleo?
I mean, yeah, it's. I mean, the whole movie's perfect. I mean, come on. There's not a flaw in this movie, I don't think, in my opinion. And I mean, I kind of already went over it, but.
No, I don't think so either.
You don't think there's a flaw? Okay, that good, good.
No.
We all agree with that, but.
Like,
and
why I mean that is, like, I wouldn't change anything about
it.
No.
Yeah.
You know?
It is. It might. You might come down to personal preference. You know.
I would have
yes,
had.
Yeah.
I would have had more playful kittens, probably. But that's
oh,
my. Like,
oh my goodness! I forgot. To talk
all the
about
cats
that.
Just walking around.
Dude, and
so
the, dude, the cats fighting in the background.
No, that
was
so amazing.
So cute.
That's so
oh
cute,
my
dude.
Goodness, dude. The cats.
It's my
are
favorite
so
parts
small.
In Varda movies.
Yeah. I mean,
the
honestly,
cats
dude,
in the background.
And Marker too.
Yeah, Marker has a lot of those too.
Marker has a lot of cats.
Yeah, and they're so small too and cute.
See, that's why they call them Left Bank, because they have all the cats in the movie.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. But I mean, it's kind of, she just it felt like a movie where everything was working for her, and she just kind of put everything together and just made something special. It's kind of hard to explain why.
It's a movie only a woman could make, for sure.
Pretty much, yeah.
Probably only Varda too. I mean, I don't know.
Both can be true.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, it just shows how Varda's amazing.
Like, Varda has a certain way about her, about filming the individual, like we've been saying this
yeah.
whole episode. She knows how to film the individual,
yeah, she
and
films people
she films
so
it very well
yeah.
in this.
And to not only just people, like, and on a literal level, to me, she films faces very well.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like, literally just the act of filming a
yeah.
face. She
literally has a movie
yeah.
called Faces Places, dude.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
yeah.
Great.
Yeah, so now one I still need to watch.
Yeah.
But even in this one, I notice, you know, there's
yeah.
a lot of, like, documentary aspects of filming the faces she does throughout
yeah.
the movie.
Would you guys consider Varda a documentary filmmaker?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
yeah. I was. It's interesting to think about, like, is she better at filming documentaries than neat features? But they're, honestly, they're almost kind of the same, honestly.
I guess this would be a good way to close us out, honestly, but especially with Varda and Marker, with both of them, what I think about the most is, to them, there was really no such thing as, okay, now I'm making a fiction film, and now I'm
yeah.
making a documentary, okay, now I'm making a comedy or whatever, or a sci-fi, right? To them, it was, I'm going to use all these forms to make my own movie at the end of the day.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
going to be, and this is true with all French New Wave directors to some degree, but we're talking about these two especially with the documentary aspect. Like, I don't think of a documentary by them the same way I would think of one, like, if I was watching a History Channel and a documentary came on.
Yeah.
You know, it's like not even the same thing at all. It's it's almost like a crime to call them both documentary.
Yeah.
But you can see why both some people would call them both documentaries just on the surface level.
Yeah. They're much more, they have much more personality than.
Oh yeah.
Yes.
Like, and the documentaries might have some fictional aspects to it, right?
Yeah.
Like you're saying with the reindeer commercial scene in
oh,
Siberia.
Yes. Oh man.
Just random moments like that. It's like, yeah, very personal. The whole theme of this podcast, you know, writing the authorship with the director is very noticeable in all three of these
yeah.
characters.
Yeah.
But
yeah, I mean, honestly, yeah. Honestly, the more I watch these two, I think these two are probably the best documentary makers
same,
in general
oh,
of all time. Like,
okay.
see,
all time.
I was gonna say that Marker is probably my favorite. Marker and Romer have been my favorite so far at going through.
Save
the
it
new
for next
way.
Week, though. That's
oh
what
yeah,
say.
Yeah,
save
yeah,
for, next
for sure.
Yeah,
we'll
yeah.
save it for next.
I
week.
I was
yeah,
gonna talk
okay,
about
next,
documentaries, dude.
Yeah,
because
yeah. next we'll just go into talking about what we're gonna do next.
Oh
week.
Yeah, so, yeah,
yeah.
Next week,
we're gonna basically conclude our episode of the French New Wave.
Yeah.
Give our overall thoughts.
So we all chose a movie that we want to talk about that we might have missed, you know.
Yeah, what we would consider our favorite of the French New Wave.
Well, no, because Cleo Probably 7 is my favorite.
Okay,
so,
well, that's true, but we already talked about
it. More importantly, one we want to talk about based on what we've watched during this.
Something that we missed. Yes, and I don't know if we'll do this for every series we do.
We'll take it as we go.
We'll figure it out. We'll flow through it. Yeah, but...
We'll flow through it.
So do each of you want to, like, introduce your movies real quick? I mean, like...
Yeah, so Danny already spoiled mine, so I'll go first earlier in the episode. Like, we are mine's gonna be Sans Soleil.
Okay.
And I love this movie.
You don't have to.
Yeah, I'm not gonna go into it. We'll save it for
mine
next
is
week.
Jules and Jim.
Yeah,
by Truffaut.
Yeah, and Sans Soleil is
Chris
Marker.
Marker.
Yeah,
Chris Marker.
And I selected Masculin, Feminine, directed by Jean-Luc Godard. So,
okay.
Check that one out, and catch you next time.